And we're back on Meet the Leaders. Hi there, I'm David Smith, and along with me, the Secretary of the State, Denise Merrill, and the President of the Connecticut League of Women Voters, Cheryl Dunson. And it's a pleasure to have both of you here today in light of election time looming large. We got a pretty good handle on lots of information from the Secretary earlier. League of Women Voters is an organization that has been around for almost 90 years or thereabouts, and still is a little bit mysterious to folks as to what you do and how you do it and what kind of information and areas that you're concerned with.
Well, the League of Women Voters, our whole mission is to inform and engage voters. We grew out of the women's suffrage movement, and that took, by the way, 72 years to achieve a constitutional amendment. So I hope it doesn't take that long for us to get disclosure or corporate speech and disengage that with money. But the suffrage leaders knew at that time getting the right to vote wasn't sufficient. We had to be informed and educated in order to cast a vote that one could do with confidence. So nowadays, 92 years later, the League of Women Voters is made of men and women who continue the mission of trying to inform residents about our electoral system and our government. And we have 28 chapters in the state of Connecticut.
You know, being in the media and journalism and so forth, maintaining that sitting on the fence standpoint is somewhat difficult, certainly in journalism, and for the League as well. But you do take positions on a number of things also, as well as passing along unbiased information.
Exactly, and thank you for raising that. We are a nonpartisan organization, which means we do not endorse candidates, we do not support political parties. However, we are also a political organization, which means that we study public policy issues, and we study them thoroughly, and then we'll take a stand. And I think our founding mothers were very wise, because they knew that sometimes the issue doesn't relate to a particular party, or it could change over the course of time. For example, environmental issues were originally, we had Theodore Roosevelt and, you know, the establishment of national parks, and now the perception is quite the opposite. So the League focuses in on the issue itself. We'll study it and take a stand, regardless of what any party's position will be.
And I suspect that stand, depending on the issue, might change from year to year, depending on how things
change
there
unfold.
Well, as we take a look at this year's election, for example, what of particular interest and concern should the voting populace be looking at that the League feels is important?
Well, actually, one of the issues is really more about the way the processes that we're using. There's so much confusion, going back to what you were talking to the Secretary of State about earlier, about what the identification requirements are. You know, how do I register to vote? You know, what do I need to vote? And that is really our major push this year. Rather than a particular policy issue, it's more about enabling voters, potential voters, to know how do you register and what identification you're going to need. Now, we are gradually making improvements under Secretary Merrill in terms of making things easier. So we are eagerly looking forward to the time when we will have online registration. So you could just online register. Right now, though, you can download a form, fill it out, and mail it in.
All right, now, here, both of you, Secretary and Cheryl, people say, okay, online registration, boy, that's about as nebulous as you can be going out there, and voter fraud is always being touted by organizations and individuals and so forth. How do we know that David Smith isn't voting 400 times this year because he's not being seen or registering online or whatever?
Well, big distinction between registering online and voting online.
Okay.
I am certainly not prepared to endorse voting online. I don't think it's secure. I think there's a lot of problems. But registering online, it should be easy, and many states do it already. I mean, we're not exactly in the front of the pack.
Mm-hmm.
So I can see a day where you do what people do with everything they do now. You can register right on your smartphone. Sure.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we do is the registration would come in to the main voter registration file and then go out to the towns, and you still check people out. The local registrars would still be in place to make sure that people are who they say they are and live where they say they live. So
okay, again, what they need to show who they are varies state to state, certainly.
Yes.
And in Connecticut, what need we at this point?
At this point, and it has been this way forever in Connecticut for a long time.
Okay.
We take the position that we must make sure that every person who is eligible to vote is able to vote. That's our bottom line.
Mm-hmm.
And what we say is, yes, you can be asked for a driver's license or some form of identification, especially if you're not on the list you say you should be on. There's all kinds of those sorts of things.
Photo is necessary?
No.
Okay, now this is something that there's a lot of confusion in some of the towns and some of the voting areas, as well as in individuals' minds. So you need not have that photo ID.
No, and I think everybody has to keep common sense in mind with all this. You know, the photo is not the important part about identifying someone. The important thing is that you are who you say you are, and you can have a number of ways of proving that in Connecticut, because we feel it's more important to make sure everyone's voting than it is to turn people away.
Okay, there are those who say, hey, without a photo, how do I know that Cheryl is Cheryl, for goodness sake? I mean, you could have foisted a bunch of identifying documents.
Theoretically, it's definitely possible, but we have to look at the facts, and we have virtually no indication that there's impersonation fraud, and that's the kind of fraud that a photo ID is supposed to prevent, where somebody's walking into the poll and they're saying that they're someone that they're not.
Exactly.
That is virtually non-existent.
And multiple voting fraud from using somebody else's a number of times.
Right. So, you know, the League has, in Connecticut, feels that really that Connecticut has struck the right balance between security and accuracy and accessibility, because that's what we look at when we look at voting systems. And I would like to echo what the Secretary of State said about online voting itself, casting your vote online. We're not there yet. We're definitely not there yet. It's something to go for. I mean, look, we've had people, hackers breaking into the Pentagon. I mean, if that's gonna, that has got to be one of the most secure systems.
Sure.
In the state of Connecticut, we have 169 towns each that are doing it their own way. I don't think they're gonna have the security mechanisms in place in order to protect that vote, to make sure. We have phishing, like, you know, you get these things on the internet and you think it's your bank telling you to please verify your account number, because, and then next thing you know, you have identity theft.
Right.
So we are definitely not ready for online voting yet, but we do hope to be in the future.
What do you estimate is the fraud level of the typical election in Connecticut, given the fact that you don't have to have your photo ID and so forth?
Virtually, in terms of actual complaints filed that someone is voting inappropriately, we have had not one complaint in the 20 years I looked back, because I really tried to look into this. Now, people will say, well, that's because they're not, the complaints aren't filed because it's too late and so forth and so on. Honestly, I think a much bigger problem is that no one's voting. I mean, the voting rates are very low.
Mm-hmm.
So the only concern I've ever heard it from, really, is students, because students will go off and they can vote, they can register to vote either at where they are on campus or at home. And that's because they're treated like everyone else. In other words, wherever you're living at the time, that is your residence, just like everyone else. So that's the only concern I've ever heard. I live in Mansfield, Connecticut, where there's a little place called the University of Connecticut. We do have, especially in a presidential years, literally thousands of students vote and register and vote on campus. And we have not had one case where someone is trying to vote who shouldn't, or no reported case of someone voting twice. Theoretically, could they vote on campus and then rush home and vote again? I suppose so. But under our new, actually under the new Election Day registration, that will be more difficult, because if you're right there in person, the registrar will be able to check the voting list, see if, at least if you're in Connecticut, if you're registered somewhere else, take you off there, put you on here, as we can with virtually any other list in our lives, if you think about it. There's no reason we can't do that right now, except that we have to get the system in place. So there are plenty of protections in terms of making sure that people aren't voting twice, excuse me, but this idea that there are massive numbers of people voting twice or not, or voting who are inappropriate, is just not true in our experience.
Cheryl, that bringing up, as the Secretary did, of younger people and so forth registering and voting. And engagement is something that I know the League is very concerned with, because as the Secretary suggested, we don't have the biggest voting rates going, and it never ceases to amaze me when I'm talking to friends or whatever, and I voted. I haven't voted in 20 years. I may have never voted. I'm going, these are intelligent people. These are people who are out in the real world and dealing with situations and bemoan the taxes and everything else that's going on. I say, and you don't vote?
I totally understand that attitude, I have to say, because that's what I used to be like. I felt that public officials were corrupt, self-interested, an individual could not make a difference. And I wasn't engaged at all, because I would go to cocktail parties, or, you know, people would talk about politics, and I would literally move away so I could find someone else to talk about theater or something, you know. And I think it's because people do feel powerless, and you need, what I say to people when they feel that way, I say, well, what have you complained about recently? And then they can identify those things really quickly. And I said, okay, well, the people that are being elected are going to be making decisions on every single thing that you've just identified. So one way is to try to select the person who you think has the least downside. You know, I mean, you're saying you don't like either one, mm-hmm. all right? Mm-hmm. But you have things you care about. So the first thing, select the one that has the least downside for those issues you care about. Secondly, it's like you're hiring someone for a job. You don't hire someone for a job and then never talk to them, never follow what they're doing, never do anything, and then 4 years later say, you know what, I didn't like the job you did, out. I said, you need to constantly communicate with them, because if there's one thing, and Secretary Merrill could probably verify this, a public official knows how to count. And if they start getting a lot of calls on a particular issue, they say, well, wait a minute, my constituents are calling me about this, what's going on? Because they're dealing with, I mean, in Connecticut alone, they're dealing with between 3,000 and 5,000 bills per session.
Sure.
Right. So there has to be something that raises something up on the radar. And what will accomplish that is calls from constituents.
We want to thank you both. I know you've got busy schedules going on, and election now 2 months or less than 2 months away. We want to thank you both for being with us, and for you at home. You can check in with the League of Women Voters website. You can check in with the Secretary of the State's website. Whatever questions you might have about voting and what kind of ID you need and so forth, issues LWV takes care of and so forth. And we want to thank you both for being a part of the program today.
Thanks for having us.
Always a pleasure.
Thank you.
And
much.
You'll breathe a sigh of relief after November.
Yes, I will.
we've got more to come in days to come. We're pleased to have the Secretary and the President and you with us. I'm David Smith. We'll catch you on Meet the Leaders next time.